God is good. Amen? Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to praise and to worship you. We thank you for the power and the anointing from your Holy Spirit. We pray, Father, blessing and health and favor upon not just us, but our children that are right next door learning this morning about you and your Son, Jesus Christ, and your Word. We pray for their teachers, for the nursery workers, for the helpers, that you would bless them and encourage them as they encourage our little children. Today, as we learn, Father, I pray that you open our hearts and our minds and our ears physically and spiritually, mentally, that we would be ready to receive all that you have for us, Father. I pray that I not be seen nor heard, but that you would be seen and heard working through me, that you alone would get all of the honor, glory, credit, and praise. We love you, and we thank you, God, that you have allowed us to be here for such a time as this, on this day, to start the new year. And what an honor it is that you've given us another day of life. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Can we give God a clap of praise? He's worthy. He's worthy, he's worthy, he's worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen. Turn in your Bibles, please, if you will, church, to the book of John, chapter 3. And I'll tell you what verse in a moment. John chapter 3. You know, when the Holy Spirit showed me what he wanted me to preach on this week, I was sitting on the couch in my house, kind of late one night, and he told me, I want you to preach on this topic, on this verse. And when he did, I just began to cry. It took me to tears, because it's a verse that is so powerful, but yet as Christians, I think it's one of those verses that we tend to just forget and take for granted, because it's just one of those verses that we've heard our entire lives. But when we take this particular verse for granted, we lose the impact and the power that it should have in our faith walk. And so we're going to study this verse pretty good today. Let's begin with John chapter 3, verse 16. The Lord showed me this on Tuesday night, and I've just been so excited ever since to give it to you and to share it with you. John 3:16, and we're going to read for a little bit, so hang with us. Here we go. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Look at your neighbor and say it. You have to go through Jesus. Okay, there is no other way. Verse 19. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. Verse 21. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in who, church? God. Amen. Now let's talk about it. This really is a wonderful opportunity at the beginning of this new year to take a look at this 16th verse. It is a verse that is so important. It is a pillar to our faith and our salvation in Jesus Christ. But as I explained earlier, at times we tend to forget it when it comes to our outreach in loving others. John 3:16 says this. Look at it, please. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world. Everybody say, loved world. All right, do it again. Love, world. And we're going to take these two words, and we're going to see the significance of God so loving the world. For God so loved the world. The word used in the Greek here is a type of agape love. It is the form from the root agape, and it's actually pronounced agapeo. So everybody, first off, say agape love. Okay, now this again is a form of agape love. It is agapeo love, spelled right here on the screen, A-G-A-P-O, agapeo love. Everybody say agapeo. We're going to learn about agapeo love in the scripture. This is something that's just mind-blowing. Most Christians that don't understand agapeo love, they're not living out agapeo love, simply for the lack of not understanding what it is. And I'm excited to share with you through scripture what agapeo love is. So let's talk about it. There's a few things that agapeo love means for you and I. But first, we're going to talk about what it means in our wonderful example of Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father God. Agapeo love is the active love of God for Jesus Christ that He has towards His Son. So everybody say agapeo love again. Agapeo love, in the first sense, agapeo love is the actual literal love that God Almighty has for His Son, Jesus Christ. Now, how many people could raise your hand and say, that's got to be an incredible love? Amen? That's got to be an incredible love. I mean, an agapeo love, the love that God has for Jesus Christ. And that is just a mind-blowing love, okay? But agape love also is to show us how much God loves us. So get this. He not only, speaking of God, God not only agapeo loves Jesus, but God also actively loves us as well. Now think about this. It's a twofold thing here. It's beautiful. Agapeo love is the love that God has for Jesus, but it's also the love that God has for us, the church, which means this. God loves the church with the same love that He loves Christ. That's incredible. That's incredible. There may be some people in here that feel they've got a real bad self-esteem problem. Maybe they feel a lack of self-worth. I'm telling you, God loves you just like He loves His Son, Jesus. That's good news. That's good news. That's incredible news that God loves you just like He loves Jesus. Incredible news. Jesus gave us a perfect example of it here on earth. You remember when He picked His disciples? But all throughout Scripture, reading Scripture, you can't tell unless you read the ending what's going to happen. You don't know who's going to betray Jesus because Jesus didn't love Judas any different than Jesus loved John. Jesus didn't love Judas any different than Jesus loved Paul. Jesus didn't love Judas any different than Jesus loved Matthew. Unless you knew the outcome, you wouldn't be able to guess who was going to betray Him. Jesus loved them all the same. Here's the good news. It doesn't matter where you are, how bad you've been, or where you're coming from. God loves you the way He loves Jesus. He loves you. Now let me tell you how He loves you, because this is what you should be looking for. And agapeo love is an active love. God desires to actively love you. Everyone in this room should see the active love of God in your life. And if you can't, it's not because God does not actively love you. It's simply because you're either A, not receiving it freely, or B, you're trying to earn it, which you can never earn the love of God. Amen. Or C, you're just not taking the time to see the sweet things that He's actively loving you with. God actively loves you in the same way that He actively loves His Son, Jesus Christ. It's an agapeo love. Now let's take it to a whole new incredible level. For God agapeo the world. For God so actively loved the world that He gave His what? Only? That's action. For God so loved, He gave His Son. Agapeo is active love. So God did not just sit back and say, I love you. God sat back and said, I agapeo you. And I love you so much that I'm going to be active in my love for you. And I'm going to come down in flesh in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to love you so much, I'm going to give you something that you could never give yourself. What incredible action in love. What incredible action in love. That He loved us so much, He didn't just say it, He showed it in action. Now let's get back to the 16th verse. Who does it say that God actively loved in this verse, church? Look at it. The world. For God so loved the who? Tell your neighbor, that's us, we're here, right? We're here. In it, but not what? Of it, okay. So God so loved the world. Now let me tell you who it's speaking of here when it says the world, when you look up the Greek word here. When it says God so actively, agapeo, God so actively loved the world, do you know who the world is that it's speaking of? It's speaking of the evil, sinful world. How many of us have been there before? Right? Because all of us were born into sin. Look at your neighbor and say, you weren't born good. That might be newsflash to some folks, hurt some people's feelings, but the Word of God says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Amen? Amen? So look at your neighbor and say, you do have some issues.
You have some issues.
Everybody in here got at least one. Hopefully the issue that you have is not the one directly beside you, right? That goes from an issue to a problem. Yeah, we don't have problems. We don't have problems. We may have issues in life, but we're so blessed that none of us are facing true hardships. We're blessed. Here's the issue. For God so loved the world, for God so actively loved the sinners. I thank God that God so actively loved sinners that now we're saved by grace. For God so actively loved this wicked world that we as a people screwed up, that He so actively loved bad folks. How many of us have been bad folks? Every one of you. If you can't raise your hand to that, you're being bad right now. We're actively loved by God. That's good news. That means that for God so actively loved bad folks that I don't have to bear the burden when I fall short and mess up. Because if He loved me then, He's going to love me now. And if He loved me yesterday, He's going to love me today. And if He loved me today, He's going to love me tomorrow. He's actively loving me. Just like when He went looking for Adam and Eve in the garden when they messed up, God was actively pursuing Adam and Eve. Let me tell you something about the love of God. He actively pursues you every day of your life, whether you realize it or not. And if you're here today and you're sitting there thinking, I don't feel God actively pursuing me, then listen, I say this with love. There's a problem, because God wants you to feel His power every day that you wake up. God desires that you feel His presence every time He gives you breath to breathe in your lungs. God wants you to know He's real. God desires you feel His presence. God desires your intimacy with Him. God wants a relationship with you that is so mind-blowing that it goes far surpass any relationship you could have with a person in the flesh on earth. God actively loves you, and He actively loves us so much that He came down for us and He died for us. He actively loves us so much that He does things that we cannot do as a people. Even if we took all of the people that ever was, ever is, and ever will be, we still could not amount to the smallest strength of God. You know, Scripture talks about how even the wisest of men does not come close, or even the strongest of men does not come close to the weakness of God. God has no weakness. God. And He so actively loves you that He desires that you feel His action every day of your life. And just as much as God is pursuing us with that love, we ought to be looking for it. Because when we're willing to open our eyes, God is willing to reveal it plainly. Amen? God so loved the world. What a thought to wake up to every morning in 2017. God so loved the world that He loved me in my good times. God so loved the world that He loves me in my bad times. God so loved the world that He loves me in my confused times. God so loved the world that He loves me in my rebellious times. God so loved the world even when I act ugly. God so loved the world that for me today, that I'm reminded that He gave His only Son in an act of love. When we're lost, when we're sinning, when we're living in the world, when we're looking like the world, when we ourselves have been led astray, and many times we're leading others astray with us before we were saved, when we were not living like saints, I thank God that He still loved us. For God actively loved the sinner. Think about that. That is a statement right there that would send most churches through the roof. Because too many churches in today's time get caught up in this religious st- stuff. And they feel as though everything needs to be perfect. Everybody hear this. God loved the sinner. And see, when we become righteous in Christ, we can at times forget that God loved us before we were righteous. God loved us when we were at our worst, and thank God He did. Amen? Think about it. I thank God that even though we once were lost, we're now what? Found. Once blind, now what? See. All because God actively loved you and me. All because God actively loved you and me. I want to take you somewhere and show you something else in Scripture. If you'll turn with me, please, to the book of Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, we're going to begin with the 9th verse. For God so loved the world. For God so loved the sinner. For God so loved the world that He actively gave His only Son, so that whoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have what kind of life? Everlasting. For God so loved the world. My prayer, church, is that you hear that for the rest of the day, and that it resonates in you. For God so loved the world. For God so loved the world. For God so actively loved a sinner. For God so loved the world. How many people know this morning that God wants to show you His love? He actively wants to show you His love. Matthew chapter 9, look at the 9th verse. The Word of God, praise the Lord, says His church. As Jesus passed on from there, He saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and He said to him, "Follow me." And he rose and followed him. Now think about this now. Jesus looked at Matthew, a tax collector, who was the worst of sinners in that time, and He says, "Follow me." And verse 10, and as Jesus reclined at the table in the house, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and were reclining with Jesus and His disciples. And when the Pharisees saw this, they said to His disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when He heard it, Jesus said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but who, church? Sinners." Jesus says, "I desire mercy." Verse 13, Jesus says, "I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." God so actively loved the world that He came looking for screwed up people. I love that about Him. Because that's how He found me. Because I was really screwed up without Him. I love the fact that He didn't just take the worst of the sinners and sweep them under the rug because He was so religious in stature that He could not be seen with them. I love the fact that Jesus wasn't worried about His reputation. Jesus was worried about salvation for others. You hear that? So many times, Christians, so many times we could be worried about who we're seen with. But how can you love on somebody the way Jesus loved on somebody if you're concerned what you're going to look like standing around the ungodly? Don't let the righteousness of Christ that makes you righteous keep you from standing beside a sinner. Because before you received Christ as your Savior, you were just as guilty as that one. See, the church today has become too religious in that sense. We become thinking as though, oh, now listen, now let me tell you, we are to be separate. But that doesn't mean that we're to separate our love. In other words, we're not to commune with them in their sin. We're not to be equally yoked in their sin with them. But it never says that we're not to stop loving. We're still to love. We're never given a free pass to just completely desert those that need the love of Christ. We're never given the ability to just say, "I'm so good that I don't want to be around those people anymore." God wants to use you to love them in the same way God used someone else to love you. And who are we to restrict the love of Christ? Who are we to strain out the love of Christ? We should be looking for the opportunity to sow seeds of love to the lost. We should be looking for a ground that is hungry and thirsty for the water of life. You know, if it rains for too many days, what can happen to your front yard?
water start to set in there. I know when it rains a lot because I get water sitting in certain spots of my yard. I don't want a ground where I'm always throwing water on wet ground. Now, I'm talking about preaching the gospel here. I desire every week that not just saved folks be here, but I'd love to see just as much unsaved as saved. I want that. I want that. I want the saved people to go out this week and bring so many unsaved people in here this week, or next week, that we're sitting shoulder to shoulder. Not just for numbers, but for the simple fact that we got some dry land that needs some water on it. Dry land that needs some water on it. Every one of us this week should say, hey, look, you need to come to hear the word of God. You desperately need to hear it. And if you'll just come, I'll even sit with you. And yeah, sure, I'm always used to sitting up front, but I'm willing to give up my up-front seat if you're willing to sit in the back. Last time I checked, there was no names on these aisles. And if someone wants to sit up here, I'm not going to say in my seat because it ain't my seat. But if someone wants to sit where I tend to sit, it's not going to hurt my feelings. And if anyone in here feels like they can't sit there because I tend to sit there, you should never feel like that. And shame on whatever made you to feel like that. That's not my chair. Because I can guarantee you, if a leg broke on it, I'm not going to keep sitting in it. I'm going to go sit in the one beside it. See, the church, and I'm talking about globally, I'm including all of the church, that the church has gotten so used to just being in the church that we forget that the church was called to leave this building and go out. Go out. Church doesn't stop when you leave here because you're the church. You see the sheetrock? That's not the church. You see that stage? That's not a church. You see the projectors and the screens? That's not church. The nice air conditions and the heat vents, that's not even a church. The seats you're sitting in are not a church. The church is everyone in here that's living and breathing with the heart functioning and beating and blood pumping through you. And you know what happens? You know what happens when the church is not the church? You know what happens when the church is not the church? Scripture says that God will even make rocks cry out. He'll use a donkey to speak to a man if the man don't act right. God will use whatever it takes. God will use whatever it takes to have his will be done. And what an awesome opportunity that he spoils us to be part of that plan. And shame on the church when we don't take the plan with us when we leave here. That's not good. Every one of us, including myself this week, should be looking for opportunities to invite the unloved to a place that's going to love. Every one of us. It should be a desperation, a plea from our soul to try to reach the unsaved to be loved. For God so actively loved the sinner. Now, I don't want anyone to raise hands, and I don't want anyone to speak out loud on this. I just want you to think about this for a minute. And I'm going to think about it myself because I'm not perfect. But I just for a minute, everybody just close all eyes. I'm not going to throw nothing at you. Everybody just close your eyes for a minute. Think about this statement. How many sinners have we loved on this week? Just think about that. How many sinners have we loved on this week? How many sinners have I invited to hear the gospel this week? How many sinners have I actively loved with the love of Christ this week? All right, everybody look up here, because this is a concern that we get so busy in us and me that we forget to love the way God loved the world. How many people can acknowledge it's real easy to love yourself? Real easy. It can be hard to love everybody else. And it can be even harder to love a sinner. It could be even harder to love somebody that doesn't love you. It can be even harder to love someone that speaks harshly of you. It can be even harder to love somebody that doesn't want to get along with you. It can be even harder to love somebody that doesn't look like you. It can be harder to love somebody that doesn't want to do the things that you want to do. It can be hard. But God never gave us permission to take the easy road.
He actively loved us and gave us the power and the strength in Jesus Christ to let His love come through us and have an effect on the lost. For God so loved the world. And listen, most Christians take that verse and they use it for themselves in salvation. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Well, let's just put that in context. For God so actively loved the sinner. See, as Christians, we take that verse for ourselves. And it is for self. But once we get saved, we now have to apply the verse in the context for the unsaved. The first part of the verse is all about the unsaved. For God so actively loved the sinner. And so once we get saved, that verse was about us in the past now. Amen? Thank God that He saved me. And now I need to give that same type of love to the unsaved. For God so actively loved this nasty world. Matthew chapter 9. Look at verse 13 again. Matthew chapter 9, verse 13. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. You see, Jesus showed the love of God to what many considered unlovable people right here in this passage. The Jews hated the tax collectors because the tax collectors would take what was due of the government, and then the tax collector got to put their own fee on top of it, and they got to choose what the fee was. Tax collectors were hated big time back then. Most of you still hate them. You'll own your home and still pay taxes as long as you're living. You can have your car paid off for 30 years, but you're still going to pay taxes on it, ain't you? You can own your land for 100 years, but you're still going to pay taxes on it, ain't you? And here's a kicker. Even when you die, you go pay taxes on it, ain't you? Oh, the death tax. Jesus was willing to love the unlovable. Jesus was willing to go reach what many considered the unreachable. And He calls every one of us to do the same thing. See, Jesus didn't come down on this earth to set an example that we only had to follow part of it. He called us to follow all of it. He said, pick up your cross and follow me how often? Daily. Not just when it's easy. Not just when the road is short. Not just when the journey is sweet. But He said, pick up your cross and follow me daily. And that means even when it gets hard, you still come with me. Even when it gets rough, you still roll with me. Even when it's hard to hear, you still listen for me. Even when you don't feel like loving, you still love. Even when you don't be obedient, you don't want to be obedient, you still fight to be obedient. You pick up that cross and you follow me. Even if you don't want to follow me, you follow me daily. Because the Lord will never lead you to where you do not need to be. If you're going to pick up your cross and walk with the Lord, you will be in the right spot every single time of your life. Do you believe that? You'll be in the right spot every single time of your life. Here's another important fact to know about the agapeos love that Jesus talked about in John, the 16th verse of the third chapter. John 3:16, for God so agapeos the world. For God so actively loved the world. Here's the next cool thing about the active love of God. It's also a love that the church should have one for one another. The agapeos love is a love that God has for Jesus, but the agapeos love is also a love that God has for us. So everybody say, God loves Jesus. We're going to learn this. Everybody say, God loves me like He loves Jesus. Okay, now watch this. The agapeos love in the same text, in the same verse. I'm not just pulling this to have a good sermon. This is really what it means. The agapeos love also means that I'm to love you like Christ loves me. That's the agapeos love. That the church would love the church the way Christ loves the church. That the church would love the church the way God loves Christ. Now, here's part four of agapeos love. This is incredible. It also means that we're to love our enemies the same way that God loves Jesus. How many people can acknowledge that that's hard? That's hard. But here should be the revelation. And I just feel the anointing. I'm so excited to share this with you. Remember earlier, we talked about how for God so actively loved the world, the sinner. If God could love a sinner so much that he sent Jesus, then shouldn't we be able to love a sinner so much that we should present Jesus? Agapeos. Agapeos love is the way God loves Jesus. Agapeos love is the way God loves us. Agapeos love is the way that we're to love one another the way that God loves Jesus. And agapeos love is that we're to love our enemies the way that God loves our enemies. For some people, that may be a pill to swallow. God loves my enemies. Yes, and many times in Scripture, he even commands you to love your enemies too. And so if God's got to love them, I'd say you got to too. Because the only reason that you're saved today is because God so loved you when you were an enemy. Everybody hear that? But they don't look like me, but they don't talk like me, but we're in a different status. We got different friends, but we don't like the same things. It doesn't matter. Because on the day of judgment, all that is going to mean absolutely nothing. And the only thing that will matter is whether or not that they have given their soul over to Jesus Christ to be saved or not. Whether they have or whether they haven't. And whether they have or haven't will determine where they spend eternity for the rest of forever. And so we need to begin to look through those lenses. We need to begin to look through those eyes. We need to begin to look through that kind of faith. That they may not look like me, talk like me, act like me, walk like me, dress like me, smell like me, live like me, have the same friends as me. But I don't see through any of that. Lord, may I see through your eyes. May I see through the faith that you want me to have. Are they saved or not? That's all that matters. Are they saved or not? That's all that matters. When I witness to people on the street, or when I witness to people in the grocery store, or witness to people and ask them if they're saved, and they say, yeah, I go to church, such and such place. And I look at them, and I just let them finish. And then I say, okay, but are you saved? Well, you know, I do this and I do that, and I let them finish, and I look at them and say, okay, but are you saved? I can't tell you how many times I've asked people if they're saved, and they go to ringing off things that they do. But they can't tell me if they're saved or not. Being saved is not about an amount of works that you put into yourself. Being saved is about believing with your heart and confessing with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Lord. And receiving him as your Savior. And so have you done that? That's all that matters. And if you've truly done that, then God will call you into doing works. Because faith without works is what? Dead, according to the Scripture. But you can never work yourself into faith. Hebrews 11:1, faith is believing without what? Seeing. You can never work yourself into faith. That's the only thing that matters. This sounds comical, but it's very sad. There's been many times I'll approach someone and say, hey, do you go to church anywhere? And they say, yeah. I say, that's great. Where do you go? And they can't even remember the name of the church. So that tells me two of two things. Either it ain't making an impact on them, or they're really not going. And so when someone tells me that they actively attend a church but can't actively tell me the name of it, right off the bat, I'm thinking, I don't think they're saved. So immediately I ask, are you saved? Because that's the only thing that matters. When you get to heaven, your job is not going to mean anything when you stand there at judgment. The amount of money that you have in your bank account is absolutely worthless on that day. Everybody hear that? Absolutely no good on that day. Who you hung out with down here on this earth is absolutely worthless on that day. Who your mom and dad is absolutely worthless at that moment on that day. Who your boss is absolutely worthless on that day. Okay? The only thing that matters is whether or not your soul has truly been saved or not. That's it. I don't know about you, but that takes a weight off of me to know that I don't have to be someone down here that I'm not. I follow Jesus. I'm a servant of the King Most High. He is Lord, and I recognize that. And anything that he asks me to do, I'm not perfect at everything. But I have a desire to get it right. And that's all he's looking for, church. He's not expecting you to be perfect without him. Because perfection only comes through him. And this is why he so actively loved the sinner. Because he knew you couldn't do it on your own. He knew that I could not do it on my own. He actively loves you so much that he came to do a work that we could not do. Look at someone near you and say, God wants to love through you. Look at somebody else and say, God wants to love through you. That was so terrible. Terrible, man. Sometimes I get off the stage and I wonder, did anybody hear a single word? Let me look at a neighbor for a minute. God wants to work through you. That's what I just heard. God wants to work through you. It excites me. I mean, I get excited that God, of all creation, actively wants to love me today. And I'm looking. And I'm not perfect. I am not perfect. But I'm looking today. Today's a new day. And new joy comes into what? In the morning, right? And it's still morning time, right? And so I'm looking for ways that God is going to actively love me. And it's already started. Before I begin to preach, someone give me a word of encouragement in the sound room and put his love around me, his arm around me, and just love me. And I knew, as soon as he did, I just felt the power of the Holy Spirit. I was like, oh God, what a charge, what a charge, what a charge. God actively loves you through people. Now, when you're actively loving the world, when you're actively loving the sinner as God did and he calls us to do, listen, it doesn't give you a permission to go sin with him. Everybody hear that? Okay? We don't. Now, look, I'm just going to be real, okay? Ain't nobody here named Larry, is it? Because I don't want anybody to think I'm talking about somebody. All right? This is not a real example. I'm just giving a example. If Larry has a little bag of pot, and you used to get high with Larry back in the day, or maybe last week. And you want to have the excuse to go show the love of Jesus to Larry while he's entertaining himself with a little pot. God has not given you a reason to go smoke some pot with Larry. You don't look at it and say, well, Pastor preached this week about loving the world, and so I know where the world's at. Down there at Larry's house at 8 o'clock every Friday and Saturday night, and I'm going to go visit the world the whole time knowing what you're walking into. God doesn't give you the reason to go do that. Now, you avoid Larry's house at that time when you know what's going on at that time. Amen? When you love the sinner, it doesn't give you a reason to sin. When you love the sinner, it doesn't give you an excuse to sin with them just so you can love them. That is a lie from the devil. That is a lie from Satan himself trying to entangle you in the old way of you. And God never called you to be the old you. He calls you in salvation to be a new you. So don't ever use the reason to love as an excuse to go screw up. Don't ever do it. Satan will try to convince you to get there, but don't follow the way of that wicked enemy. Now, you love the person on your terms, on your grounds, when they're not actively participating in that sin. But every one of us should be looking for the sinner to love. Turn with me, if you will, church, in the book of John, chapter 4. Let's see what the book of John has to say about it. John, chapter 4. We're going to go to the first verse. I'm going to see Jesus talking with a Samaritan woman. Did not look like Jesus. Did not look like a Jew. Did not act like a Jew. Did not speak like a Jew. Jesus talking with this Samaritan woman. John chapter 4, verse 1. The word of God, praise the Lord, says this, church. Now when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Now, I hadn't I did not know I was going to say this. I wasn't prepared to say this, but I do feel led by the Holy Spirit to tell you this. Look at verse 5. Speaking of Jesus. So we came to a town of Samaria called Sychar near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Verse 6. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, what's that next word? Wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Do you know when God came in flesh, he was experiencing everything in the flesh that we experience in the flesh. God not only actively loved you so much and loved me so much that he sent his son Jesus, but God so actively loved us so much that he sent him in a flesh suit like we have so that he would know the temptation, the pain, the torture, the torment that we go through on a daily basis so that when we cry out to him, he knows exactly what we're talking about and we can't use the excuse that God's so good he don't know. God is so good he came down to know. See, there's certain things that the angels can't feel. There's certain things that the angels can't do. The angels cannot receive the gift of salvation, so they have no idea what the gift of salvation is on the terms of knowing what it was to not be saved and now have joy of being saved. There's certain things that the heavenly beings can't feel or express that we can because we were here in flesh. Do you know that? If not, now you do. So you can rejoice in ways that the angels can't even rejoice in. You'll be able to give praise on the day of salvation. You'll be able to give praise on the day of judgment. You'll be able to give praise on the day that we kick off eternity in ways that the angels can't. Now, in the same sense, the angels will be able to praise in ways that we can't because we don't know what it is to have been there for all eternity and created like that from the get-go. And you can find all that in Scripture to back it up. That's a whole other topic. But I'm just letting you know, don't you ever feel like God doesn't know what you're going through, because Scripture lets us know when he came down here on earth, he suffered, he was weary, and he was tempted in every way. You remember when Satan was tempting him? He knows what it is to be tempted. Now, you may think, oh, God just don't know what I'm going through. No, you just don't know what he went through. You have to understand that God loves you. Look at what it says next. Verse 7. A woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. And the Samaritan woman said to him, How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. And Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Everybody say living water. Oh, that's good stuff. Verse 11, the woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will again be thirsty, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." She was thinking physical. Jesus was thinking spiritual. Now think about this. Jesus himself, God in flesh, went and sat down next to a woman that normally Jews would not associate with. They would not be seen talking to. And here he went, as we just read a few minutes ago with the tax collectors, now he's with a Samaritan. Not just a Samaritan, but it's a woman. He's talking to a Samaritan woman. And the disciples roll up on this. And they see that their Lord, their King, their Messiah is speaking to this Samaritan woman. Let me tell you something. We better not ever have our guard up so much that we're not willing to talk to the sinner. God himself spoke to the worst of the worst. God himself spoke to the low of the low. God himself spoke to the dirtiest of the dirty. And he loved every one of them in the process of speaking. Loved every one of them. Not only did Jesus love her here, but he introduced her to living water. Now, it's easy to love someone, but it can be difficult to love them and present the gospel. Has anybody ever had a hard time witnessing to somebody before? Just don't know what to say. We're just uncomfortable around them. Just don't know how to start. Let me tell you something. Don't just love them. But while you're loving them, introduce them to the living water. Introduce them to the living water. It would do no good if everyone came to church all over the world every Sunday and salvation was not presented. What good would that do?
I don't understand as churches, how come there's so many churches that don't give an opportunity to receive Christ at the end of every service? What good is that? So the saved came to be encouraged, but what about the unsaved that were coming empty looking for something and leave still empty looking for something? Don't just love them. Don't just stop there, but you love them and you present the living water to them. Verse 15, again, John chapter 4, verse 15. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water." Some of you here today may have a barrier in your life, and Jesus, being around the Jews, there were barriers that he was confronted with every day of his ministry, pretty much. Jesus was talking with a Samaritan woman, and it was a barrier that man had set up. And Jesus is proving a point here. Jesus crossed over the barrier. Jesus crossed over the line that man had created. And Jesus crossed it with love, with the declaration of the good news of the living water that everyone could have. There was a man-made barrier separating two groups of people. And it was not a barrier of love. It was a barrier there. It was a barrier of the enemy. It was a separation. And all of a sudden, Jesus, in an example and a witness of love for everyone, Jesus crossed over the barrier that was made by man. Some of you, listen to this. Some of you here today may have a man-made barrier in your life, keeping you from loving other folks just from another influence or from an outside influence. Let me tell you, the good news is that if Jesus was willing to cross over a man-made barrier to love the unlovable, then every one of us should be able to do the same thing. Every one of us. I don't care if someone comes up to me and says something. Lynn, can I use you for an example? I don't care if... Junior, can I use you for an example? I don't care if Junior comes up to me and says something harsh and bad about Jen. He's not going to deter my way of thinking towards this individual. You understand that? Because she's never hurt me. I'm going to love her. And even if she did hurt me, I'm still supposed to what? Love her. I'm not going to care. And when Jesus saw that line and the Samaritan woman is there, he crossed over the line that man had created, and he loves her, and he introduces her to a living water that she knew nothing about. Now it gets even better than that. The woman had been married time and time and time again. He says, "Woman," if you read on, he says, "Woman, go get your husband." And she makes a little comment, and he says, "Well, that is true, but you've had many husbands." So he kind of tells on her a little bit. See, I like to think that right there Jesus is thinking, don't come at me, woman, with a smart aleck comment. Now I'm going to let you know that I really know about you. So he says, "Oh, yeah, you're right in saying that. You've had many." And do you know, even after her sin was exposed, Jesus still loved her. That's incredible stuff. Even after Jesus exposed her, he still loved her. And so it should not matter if someone brings a heap of ruin to your home. You're still called to love them. And that's a hard pill to swallow for some folks. But let me tell you, Jesus told us to love our who? Enemies. You, when you get offended, you, by loving them, may be the only person that can change them. Because somewhere, God will wake that enemy up and say, "You keep dumping on them and dumping on them and dumping on them, but look how they keep loving you for it." So many Christians get offended and run. God's looking for the believer that gets offended and loves. Offended and loves, 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 offended and loves. And you say, "Where do I stop? Where do I stop loving?" You never do. Where do I stop forgiving and forgetting? You never do. You never do. You cross that line every time it's built. You break that fence every time it goes up. You just keep loving. For God so actively loved the sinner.
It doesn't just say God so loved the sinner, because it's really easy to just love someone and not be involved with them. But you cannot agapeos love someone and not be involved with them. For God so actively loved, if you're going to agapeos love someone like God calls us to, you're going to have to actually do something to love that individual. And if you can't physically look someone in the eye and love them, then surely you can write down on a card some appreciation that you have. Surely you can send a Bible verse in a letter to the person. Surely you can love them with not having to be present with them. For God so actively loved the world. God never gives us a reason to check out. Look at your neighbor and say, we can't go nowhere. God never gives you an excuse to check out. God never gives you a reason to leave. God never gives you a reason to set up a barrier where he cannot work through it. God never gives you a reason to do that. Now, there's times when Scripture says, put on your sandals and leave the town. But that's a whole nother topic. You can't use that Scripture right here. That ain't talking about love. That's talking about people that just absolutely have rejected the gospel and no longer want to do it. I'm talking about loving folks. We're never given a reason to not love. Never. You know, if anybody had a reason to not love somebody, it'd have been Jesus. Even, and we talked about this last week, even when Christ was on the cross, he still looked down at the people who put him there. And he said, Father, not condemn them. He said, Father, not hate them. He said, Father, forgive them. You can't get no more love than that. Forgive them. He looked down and he seen the people that had put the thorns on his head. He looks down and he sees the people that beat him and whipped him and lashed him and tore the flesh off his back. Scripture says, when you get into the original language, Scripture says that he was unrecognizable like an animal. That they had so beat him to the brink of death that those who knew him could not look at him and know who he was. We don't have a clue on the fullness of the brutality that our Lord took for every one of us. We don't have a clue. Not on the fullness of it. He was beaten so bad that his own could not recognize him. And he so loved us still that he didn't get offended when the people did it. You know, in our flesh, we can look at people and we can say, well, they deserve it. How many people have thought that before? Well, they did this, and so I'm doing that. How many people have thought this before? God actively loved you. God actively loved me. And he looked down and didn't say, they deserve it. He looked down and said, forgive them. Forgive them. And what I love about it is when he looked down and said, forgive them, he didn't end there. One of the sinners repented and his heart was right. And he said, today you'll be with me in paradise. And we talked about that last week. But then all of a sudden, Jesus didn't go to heaven and get mad. Jesus went to heaven and he sent back the Holy Spirit. See, when they tried to kill him forever, he didn't retaliate in anger. He could have had every right to set his fist down, to stamp his foot and shake the earth and bust it wide open and just destroy everybody. He had every right to do that if he wanted. You know what Jesus did rather than get mad? This is incredible. Jesus didn't get revenge. Jesus didn't spat back in their face. Jesus didn't smack them around as a nation and make them walk in the desert lonely and lost again. Jesus sent his Holy Spirit. And he said, yeah, you hated me. But now I'm going to give you the fullness of me. My spirit will rest in man. And when we hung him on the cross, he still actively loved us so much that he sent the gift to the church, the Holy Spirit. And it was the church that put him up there on the cross. It was the priests and the religious zealots and the leaders that put him up there. And he still so loved the church that he sent his Holy Spirit down to the men who would freely receive it. That's incredible. The next time someone really gets you going, just love them. Father, forgive them. Father, forgive them. Help me, God, to love them because I don't feel like loving them right now. But I know your word commands me to love them. See, We must be careful of our witness, church. Listen to this. We must be careful in our witness that we are not guilty of only loving the comfortable, that we're not guilty of only loving when it's easy, that we're not guilty of only loving those that we already know. We must not be willing to love only when it's convenient for us to love. We must not be willing to love only when it's easy for our time or our resources. But we must actively love whoever, wherever, and whenever, and however it's going to take. For God so did it. We should not, hear this, we should not put limitations or restrictions on who we are willing to love. And I'm going to repeat that. We should not put limitations or restrictions on who we're willing to actively love. Actively. I say actively. In closing, we go here. Go to Romans chapter 8. Please. Romans chapter 8. Let me just show you something about God so loving the world. Romans chapter 8, we're going to begin with the first verse. There is therefore now no condemnation. Amen? Thank God for that. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Verse 2. For the law of the Spirit of life, capital S there, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done away what the law weakened by the flesh could not do. By sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, He condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the what, church? Spirit. Verse 5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit of God set their minds on the things of the Spirit of God. Verse 6. For to set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Listen, if you're not willing to actively love, you're not pleasing your Father. You hear that? If you're not actively loving, you're not pleasing your Father. Verse 9. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit of God. If, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you, anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to Him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit of life because of righteousness, if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit who dwells in you. Glory to God. Listen to this. Praise the Lord, church. Listen to this. All of this happened because God so loved the world that according to John 3:16, He gave His only Son that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have what? Eternal life. Now listen to this. Because God so loved the world, you're no longer condemned, and that's because you're in Christ Jesus. Because God so loved the world, the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Because God so loved the world, God did what the law could not do. Because God so loved the world, the Spirit of God dwells in you. And all because of this agapeos love, where Almighty God has decided to actively love you even when you were still a sinner. Even when you were still a sinner. In John 3:16 it says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Have eternal life. God so loved you that He has allowed you to be here today. He so loved you. God so loved you that He forgives you when no one else wants to. God so loves you that He gives the ability and the power and the authority to be healed in the name of Jesus. God so loved you that He provides for you. For Scripture says that He provides for the birds of the air and the lilies of the field. How much more for you? God so loves you that He does not need you. He does not leave you in want. You hear that? He does not leave you in want. He gives you everything you need. Everything you'll ever need, God will provide for you. Because He so loves you. Actively. actively. He's actively loving you every day of your life. And every one of you, when you wake up every day, you should be excited to see how God is going to reveal His love to you in that new day. You should be excited to look for the opportunities to let God love others through you. You should be excited to love the same way that God loves Jesus. You should be excited when you leave here today that you're loved by God the same way that God loves Jesus Christ. You should be excited that God loves you the way He loves His Son. That should bring true joy, that you're loved by God. And there's no limitation on it. There's no limitation on the love of God. When He loves you, He sells out and He loves you. When He loves you, He sells out and He loves you. And that's why He can be on that cross and He can look down and say, "Father, forgive them," because His love does not come with limitations. Do you hear that? He could look down into people that put Him there and He could still say, "Forgive them," because there's no limitation to the love of God. Because He loved those people that put Him on that cross the same way He loves Jesus. And that may be a hard pill to swallow, but that's the truth of the Word. He loved them the same way He loved Jesus. And that's why He can speak and say, "Forgive them. They know not what they do. Forgive them." Somebody has offended you, then you just pray, "Father, I forgive them. God, make it right between us. Don't let the enemy work in my mind, in my heart, in my life. God, forgive them. I don't hold them accountable. God, I thank You for the times that You've not held me accountable when I deserved it. So who am I to hold someone else accountable when they don't deserve it? Or when they do deserve it? Or when I feel that they deserve it? Or when I feel that they don't deserve it? Who am I?" You see, in flesh, we can put so many restrictions on ourselves that we even restrict our love, and we even restrict the way we allow God to work in our lives. We even restrict the way that we allow the Holy Spirit to flow through us. But I'm telling you, who are we to restrict the things of God? Who are we to say, "No, God, I won't love this person. No, God, I won't forgive this person"? Who are we? When He was willing to just forgive, forget, and love, will you stand and pray with me? If you have a desire to see the love of God work in your life every day, and we're just going to have a moment of prayer, I invite you to come forward this morning. If you truly have a heart's desire to see the love of God in your life, please come forward. We're going to pray. If you're here today and you have a desire to love others the way that God loves Jesus, I invite you to come forward. If you have a desire to love others the way that God loved Jesus, please come forward. If your new heart cry this morning is, "God, I want to love everyone the way that You love Jesus, because that's a perfect love. That's an unending love. It's a never-ending love. It's a love without limitations. It's a love without blemish." You're here today and you have a desire to love the church the way Christ loved the church. I welcome you to come forward. We're going to pray. If you're here today and maybe you've got some enemies, maybe you got some people around you that you just don't like, in your life, at home, at the workplace, in your family, and you want to have a new heart, you don't want your heart to be hardened, but you want it to be softened, and you want it to be in tune with the power of the Holy Spirit, you want to be able to love your enemy the way that Christ so loved the sinful world, then I'm going to invite you to come forward. We're going to pray. If you just have a desire here today where you just want to ask God to use you, to love through you, to work through you, then you're welcome to come forward. We're going to pray. We're going to pray. God, use me. Love through me. God, just love through me in ways that I could never love anyone else. Father, I pray for the person that's up here that wants to love people the way that You love them. I pray right now in the name and the blood of Your precious Son, Jesus Christ, that You would anoint them with that love. God, I pray that their touch would be extra special. I pray, Father, that the desire that they have to administer the love of Jesus Christ would be so anointed. It would be a new gift that is exposed in their lives. Father, that they would be able to love in ways that they never imagined they could love before. That they would find themselves loving people that normally they did not love. That they would find themselves, and I believe this is a prophetic word for someone here, if not everyone that is here for this. You will find yourself speaking to a group of people, to a class of people that you have never considered yourself talking to before. You will find yourself in the uncomfortable realm, but yet it will no longer be uncomfortable because the peace of God will make you comfortable. From this day forward, I prophetically speak this. It will be natural to you. It will be natural to you. It will be as though that gift has always been there, because it has. It has. It has. You've just not recognized it into this point. And so what God has given you to be strong in, Satan has tried to steal that from you, which is why it has been so hard to speak to them, because Satan has tried to combat your gift. You hear me? Satan has been trying to combat your gift. But from this day forward, it shall be easy in the name of Jesus. God, I pray for the people that have a desire to love the church the way you love the church. God, that they would have a heart of service, that they would have a desire to be a servant of the Most High God, not just in their personal life, but to bless others in their personal lives. Father, that you would speak to them in this desire, that you would bless them in this desire, and God, that you would fulfill the giftings and the needs that they have to be servants to those that they stand beside every Sunday morning, that they sit beside every Wednesday night. Maybe they don't know anyone in here well yet, but God, may it come to be that they soon will. God, as they begin to serve to their left and to their right, to the front and to the back, God, that as they begin to serve those in the church around them, God, may they be blessed by serving. I pray that they be blessed by serving in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for the person that's up here, and maybe they got problems in their family or friends or at work or at home, and they just want to love an enemy the way that you love the sinful world. They just want to love an enemy so that when something happens, they can look as you did down from that cross and say, Father, forgive them. I will not retaliate, but I'll give love. I'll give a gift of love the way that God sent down His Holy Spirit as a gift of love to the church. I'll give a gift of love. And God, I pray that we would be quick to say, God, forgive. God, forgive them. I forgive them. And we'd be quick to love and send a gift of some sort, even if it's just a text message or a phone call or an email or a letter in the mail, that we'd love, because that quick gift keeps the enemy from working in the mind of the offended. That quick gift keeps the enemy from working in the mind of the offender. That quick gift of love tramples down all fear. That quick gift of love tramples down all hate. Love. Actively loving those that some consider unlovable. Use us, Father, for your glory. I pray that as we leave here today, every one of us would look for ways to experience your mighty love. Every one of us. God, I pray that it would rest fresh on us. I pray that we'd not miss the little things. I pray that our eyes would be open to receive the little things as well. God, I pray that this word, your word, would never leave our hearts or our minds, that it would refresh our soul. Today, as we go forth in actively loving the unreachable, the unlovable, the unthinkable, may we be the ones that you use to cross. cross lines. May we be the ones that you use to cross borders. May we be the one that you use to break down walls and barriers. May we be the one that you use to love people that maybe we thought we'd never love again. Use us. Use us. God, please use us. In Jesus' name. We're going to give a moment for anyone in here that's not yet received Jesus Christ as your Savior. If you're here today and you've never accepted Christ as King, there's no better time to do so than now. And if you're ready for that, would you just raise your hand where you are if you need that in your life? If you've never asked Jesus to be Lord, if you've never confessed with your mouth and believed with your heart, if you need that and you're here, would you raise your hand? Would you raise your hand if you need that today? Anybody here that's unsaved? Anybody here that's unsaved that needs that? Anybody here that needs that? Then what I'm doing is assuming that everybody's right and ready, which means we got a lot to do this week to bring in the sick in this place next week. We got a lot to do this week to bring in the lost in this place next week. Everybody listen to me. We got a lot to do next week to bring in the hurt in here next week. We got a lot to do this week to bring in the sick and those that need a doctor next week. What good is it? What good is it if we come just to be strengthened for ourselves and we put more water on water ground, but yet we ride past friends and family and leaders in the community that are so desperately dry that they're parched and don't know why? What good is it if we can't throw some water on dry ground? And so myself included, we've got work to do this week. I want every one of us to be excited about the potential of salvation for someone that you bought. That's our job. To so love the sinner. To so love the unloved. To so love the unreachable. And to bring them in to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated for just a moment. In Jesus' name, amen. Colin, I'm going to ask you to come up for a minute. Colin's going to be leaving soon. He's back from basic training. And many of you throughout the years have asked, hey, you know, do you know of a soldier personally that we can be a blessing to or that we can write cards to at holidays and just write letters of thanks and encouragement? And there's been opportunities throughout the years where that has happened. But now we've got one that's close to home, that is part of our home. Amen. And so when it's made available where he'll be stationed at, you can see Brother Bob in the sound room or myself, and we'll make available, or I'll send out an email to everybody. We'll make available his address, so you can just send him cards, let him know what's happening in the town and the church, and just be a blessing to him and his wife. They recently got married. Brittany, go ahead and stand up. This is Brittany in the back. Amen. Amen. All right, so this would be a blessing for him. We're going to pray for him, and then you're going to be able to leave. Let's pray. Father, we just pray blessing and favor and honor and protection on our brother's life right here. We thank you, Father, for individuals like him. And God, we just thank you in faith in advance that he'll return home safe. We thank you, God, that you're building him into the man that you've called him to be, a true disciple of Jesus Christ in his personal life, now being a new husband. Continue to grow him in that. I pray, Father, that he be a man that searches your word. I pray, Father, that he would seek your understanding before his own. I pray that he would have an ear to hear clearly from you. As we all grow every day in our faith walk from the time to the time that you take us home, continue to grow this brother as well, and may he take heed to the call. We thank you, God, for him. May he always have a loving hand near him and around him. Bless he and his wife as they prepare to leave. Strengthen them. And I pray that they would find a wonderful, wonderful network of good, God-fearing Christian families to be around wherever they go. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Love you, brother. God bless you. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.